Hi, everybody, and welcome to Psych 1110, Elementary Statistical Reasoning. What I want to do in this video is just give you a basic introduction to the first section of our first chapter. So it's section 1.1. And I just want you to sit back and enjoy it. It won't take all that long, and you don't necessarily need to take any notes because I'm going to give you some notes already printed out in class. What I'm trying to do here really is get you used to watching videos before class and just give you a sense of what these videos will be like. So in this particular section, we're going to talk about where statistics fits into science in general, and then I guess a little bit more specifically where statistics fits into your life. And then we'll start talking about some basic statistical terminology. So we'll make distinctions between descriptive and inferential statistics, for example. We'll talk about a variety of things. And some of these other topics, they come up later in chapter one, so we'll talk about those later on. So let's jump right in. Let's talk about this scientific process. Science really is just some method of asking questions and finding answers. And let me give you a good example. I'm a psychologist, and you're all interested in how the body works, I presume. So let's say that I have this theory that depression is somewhat related to brain chemistry. And if I have that theory, I can then at that point generate some testable hypotheses to see if there's support for that theory. That's what makes something scientific. Otherwise, we're just talking about philosophy, you know, people thinking about various things. So I'm thinking about brain chemistry, and I'm thinking that it's related to depression. And at that point, I can generate some testable hypotheses. So for example, I might think that neurotransmitters like serotonin are implicated in one's mood. And I have a sense that people who have a problem with serotonin levels also have a problem with depression. Well, at that point, I can design a study. So I can work with someone to create some type of drug that influences serotonin levels in one's brain chemistry. And I can give some people that drug and some people a placebo. So you can see I'm designing an experiment in this particular case. And then at that point, I can collect some data. So some people are going to receive this drug. Some people are going to receive a placebo. And then after maybe 3, 4, 5 months, I'm going to measure them again on depression, and I'm going to see if the people who receive the actual drug are less depressed. So in general, that's what science is all about. That's how it works. So where does statistics fit into this process? Well, if you think about it, science just guides us to observe and measure things. It provides us with a set of principles, essentially, for rigorously measuring things and figuring out what's really going on. Statistics really then just provides us with some tools for analyzing the data that we collect. Science is all about observing things, measuring things, collecting data. When we measure things, we have data as a result. So how do we make sense of that data? We make sense of that data through statistics. Now that brings us to two good definitions for statistics, because there are really two ways that we can see statistics. One is that statistics is the science of collecting, organizing, and interpreting our data. So all semester long, we're going to talk about the science of statistics. We're going to talk about how to collect data, organize data, make sense of that data. But there's another way that people use the term statistics, and it's probably the way that you're more familiar with. And in this particular way of thinking about statistics, statistics actually are the data that describe and summarize what we've measured. So for example, you might be thinking about medical statistics. Somebody might be thinking about sports statistics. There we're actually talking about the numbers, and that's just a good example of how we can use the term statistics in a couple different ways. Let's go through a couple examples really quickly just so you can see how those two definitions are different from one another. So here's an example using that first definition. Later in the semester, we're going to use statistics to make sense of our survey data. So we are going to design a survey, collect some data, and then make sense of that data. Here in this particular sentence, when I say that we will use statistics to make sense of our survey data, we're talking about using the science of analyzing data to make sense of that data. So that would be that first definition and how that comes into play. Here's an example of the second definition. According to official statistics, the USA won more gold medals than any other country in the most recent Olympic Games. Here you can see when we're talking about official statistics, we're talking about some summary of the actual data. You know, we count up, for example, how many gold medals each country has won. So we're talking about the actual data in this case, a summary of that actual data. And here would be an example of that actual data. Here we can see the United States, and here's a frequency, the actual number of gold medals that they won in the most recent Olympics. So that's just an example of how we can use the term statistics in that second definition. All right, our textbook has these sections that are labeled time out to think, and sometimes they're actually pretty good. And I wanted to go over this one with you because I think it makes an important point about how statistics fits into our lives. And essentially says that scientists are smart. And I think most of you would agree that scientists typically are pretty smart people. Now think about how a scientist makes decisions. They make decisions about things based on looking at and understanding their data. So scientists don't really know what's going on with the things they're studying until they've collected data, looked at that data, and learned from that data. Well, so how does statistics fit into our lives? We want to be smart. And at that point, you can see how statistics fits into your own life because we want to be capable of making decisions based on data. So decisions that relate to our own lives, we want to be able to look at data and be able to make some decisions based on some supported evidence. In other words, we want to be quantitatively literate. My goal this semester is to help you get comfortable looking at data, to help you get comfortable analyzing data, playing with the numbers, so that you can see what's really going on with the data that we've collected, and then make decisions about that data. All right, let's proceed along with this particular section of the textbook. We start talking now about the statistical process, and there are basic steps in any type of study that we conduct. Remember, with statistics, we're going to analyze data, so data that was collected in some type of research study. And if you think about any statistical research study, we're going to have five basic steps. Let's talk about each one of those steps in detail. Of course, these are outlined in your textbook and you can follow along. And at any point, you know, during one of these videos, you can just stop and, you know, read on the screen a little bit more clearly what you might have missed, or backtrack a little bit, or look in your textbook, whatever you need to do. So if you feel I'm going too fast sometimes, just hit pause. We're going to talk about each one of these steps. So step one. In step one, we really need to determine what our goals are, and that makes sense. Before you start doing anything, it's pretty smart to determine what you want to accomplish. Now, in this particular sense, when we're trying to determine goals, we really want to determine what population we want to learn about. A population is simply some complete set of people or things that we want to study. So, for example, think about a presidential election poll. And we hear a lot about presidential election polls during campaign time. Identify the population for a presidential election poll. Well, remember, the population of interest is the complete set of people or things that we want to study. Well, I want to know about everybody who is going to vote on election day. That would be the population of interest. It's not necessarily registered voters, because not all registered voters vote. It's not all adults. It's the people who actually vote. That would be the population of interest. So this is usually a pretty easy step, you know, determining who that population really would be. Now, from that population, what I want to do is measure some characteristics. Well, those characteristics are known as population parameters. So population parameters are simply characteristics of a population. So of all those people who are going to vote in the upcoming election, the people who I'm going to poll, what might I want to learn about them? Well, for example, I might want to know who they're going to vote for, right? So I might want to know the proportion or percentage of people who plan to vote for one of the candidates, let's say Obama. And let's say we know that 52% of the people voted previously for Obama. Let's say that that's true. That would be the population parameter corresponding to the percentage of people who voted for Obama. Now, of course, when I'm doing a poll, I'm trying to predict who they're going to vote for. So I'm using that polling data to predict this population parameter. So another thing that I might be interested in finding out from my poll would be the average age of a voter. So of these people in the population that I'm going to speak to, I can collect some data about their age. Now, when I compute an average in statistics, we typically call that a mean. And when I'm dealing with a population parameter, meaning it's an average for the entire population, I use a symbol like this. The symbol is a Greek letter, mu, M-U. And I just put a little subscript representing the age. So let's say the average age of a voter is 44. Again, that's a population parameter. It's simply a characteristic from the population. Let's talk about another population parameter. How many people are going to vote in the upcoming election? Let's say about 130 million people vote. Well, this N, you can see it's capitalized. It represents the number of people in the population. And again, that's a characteristic of the population, how large it is. So it is a population parameter. All right, so when I design a study, I want to determine what population parameters I'm interested in learning about. And in this case, I'm definitely interested in knowing the proportion of people who plan to vote for each candidate. All right, well, let's move on from there. Let's talk about step two, because you can probably see we're running into a problem. There's no way that I'm going to be able to measure 130 million people and ask them who they plan to vote for in the upcoming election. So we can't measure all voters. Step two, choose an appropriate sample from the population. Now we're going to talk about samples in quite a bit more detail when we get to the next section of the textbook. But for right now, let's just make sure we understand the basic definition and the concept. A sample is simply a subset of the population. So we can't measure the entire population. We're going to measure a subset, which we call a sample. Now, here's an important question. If we're going to learn about that entire population of voters based on just a sample of those voters, what would need to be true? Now, think about it. If we're only going to measure some people, a sample from that population, we need to make sure that those people represent the entire population. So the sample must represent the population. If it does, if that sample is representative of the population, then we can learn about the population by only collecting data from the sample. It's really an amazing thing because I can learn about a very large population of people, like the population of voters, by just measuring a relatively small sample, just a couple thousand people, for example. I can learn about that population of voters with quite a bit of amazing accuracy. So what exactly is a representative sample? A representative sample is simply a sample that has the same characteristics as the population. So remember we said that the population had an average age of about 44? Well, our sample should have an average age of about 44. If the population of voters for the presidential election consists of 55% women, I would want to make sure my sample has about 55% women. So a representative sample will have the same characteristics as the population. Okay, let's talk about step three. For step three, we collect some raw data from that sample, and then we summarize that data by computing what we call sample statistics so that we can understand what we've learned from that sample. So, for example, from that raw data that we collect, we can compute some sample statistics. For example, I might find that the sample proportion of people who said they were going to vote for Obama is 51%. Now, what's this little caret here? This little caret on top of the P represents a sample proportion. Remember, this was the population proportion. So we know after the fact that 52% of the people voted for Obama. Now in my sample, when I measure, you know, just a couple thousand people, for example, I might find that 51% of them plan to vote for Obama. That's what we call a sample statistic. So a sample statistic is simply some characteristic of the sample. In this case, the proportion of people who plan to vote for Obama. Remember, we know from that population that the average age is 44. So the population mean, mu, equals 44 years old. Well, I might find that in my sample of 1,000 or 2,000 people, the average age is equal to 45. This X bar represents a sample mean. So we have a population mean and a sample mean. So when I collect data from that sample, I'm going to compute some various summary statistics, like the proportion of people who plan to vote for Obama and the average age from that sample. So these are good examples right here of sample statistics. These are examples right here of population parameters. Now, population parameters and sample statistics are examples of what we call descriptive statistics. Descriptive statistics simply describe our data. It's really that easy. So you can see we're describing the number of people or proportion of people who plan to vote for Obama. We're describing the average age. So descriptive statistics are really very straightforward. And we'll spend the first several weeks of our semester talking about descriptive statistics. So again, thinking about this process, we collect some raw data from our sample. And then when we collect that data, of course, we want to summarize it. We're going to summarize that sample data with sample statistics. Okay. Now, you've probably noted there's a difference here between the population parameter and the sample statistic that is trying to represent the population parameter. Let's talk about that next. Step four is all about drawing inferences from those sample statistics to the population. But as I mentioned, our sample statistics don't typically perfectly represent the population parameters. That's what sampling error is all about. So because of sampling error, the sample statistics will not correspond perfectly to population parameters. I mean, think about it. Let's be reasonable. If there are 130 million people who are going to be voting in a presidential election, and I measure 1,000 or 2,000 of those people randomly selected, do I really think my sample data is going to perfectly correspond to the population data? No, it's not going to perfectly correspond. Now, if I use good sampling techniques, it's going to come pretty close. But the difference that we see here between the sample statistic and the population parameter is what we call sampling error. So it doesn't mean I made an error. It's just that because I'm not measuring the entire population, my sample statistic will not be perfectly representative of the population. There will be a difference, and that difference is known as sampling error. Again, the difference between these two values, the population parameter and the sample statistic, is what's known as sampling error. Now, if we collect data from samples, how will we ever know the exact value of the population parameters? And the real answer is we won't. I'm not going to know from collecting data from 2,000 people exactly how many people plan to vote for Obama. But using inferential statistics, we can determine how well these sample statistics represent these population parameters. Inferential statistics get much more complicated. We're going to talk about inferential statistics during the latter part of our semester. And essentially what they're going to do is help us determine how well these sample statistics represent these population parameters, how well they estimate these population parameters. I'll give you an example. So, for example, you're probably familiar with the term margin of error. We're going to talk about that quite a bit later on this semester, and you'll get a much better sense for how to compute it and what it means. Well, the margin of error provides a range of values, or what we statisticians call a confidence interval, that is likely to contain the true population parameter. So what does that mean? Let's go through an example. Well, let's assume the sample proportion of people who plan to vote for Obama is 52%. So remember, we measured 1,000 or 2,000 people, and from those 1,000 or 2,000 people, we found that 52% plan to vote for Obama. So that's why we have the little caret above the P. It represents the sample proportion. And let's say that we compute that the margin of error equals 3%, because we know the true population value is not 52%. We know that those 130 million people are not going to give us exactly 52% voting for Obama. So this number is, we're hoping, close to the true population value, but we know it's not exact. That's why we compute a margin of error. And let's say we compute that value and it equals 3%. What does it really mean? What it means is that the true population proportion of people who plan to vote for Obama is likely to range from 49% to 55%. So it's clear enough to see where we got that. We just took 52% and we subtracted 3%. That would equal 49%. And then I took 52% and I added 3%. That would equal 55%. So what I'm saying is, from my sample data, I can estimate that the true population parameter representing the number of people or proportion of people who plan to vote for Obama, is likely to range from 49% to 55%. Now think about what that tells us. Our sample data was showing us that Obama is leading. Obama has the majority of people planning to vote for him. But we know that that value doesn't represent the population parameter perfectly. When we take into account the margin of error, we can see his support might actually be as low as 49%, which would mean he does not have the majority of support in that particular case. But it's possible that 55% of the population who plans to vote would actually support him. So here we have a range of values, and that range of values is what we call a confidence interval. So how do we interpret that confidence interval? Those confidence intervals are based on what we call a 95% confidence interval. And what that means is 95% of the samples that we could select would contain the actual population parameter within that interval. So if we were to essentially rerun our study 100 times, 95% of the time, 95 times out of 100, the value that we find from our sample, when you add and subtract the population, the margin of error, would include that true population parameter. So let me just say that again. 95% of the time, when we take that sample proportion, and then we add and we subtract the margin of error, that range of values that we compute will include the true population parameter. So that's why we say we can be 95% confident that the true proportion of people who will be voting for Obama is between 49% and 55%. All right, so that's an example of inferential statistics. We're using our sample data to draw inferences about the population of voters. We're not measuring the entire population of voters, we're just measuring a sample, but we're learning about that true population of voters, that complete group of people. All right, so step five, we draw conclusions about what we've learned from that study. In that particular case, we learned that Obama has a lead, but it's somewhat of a tenuous lead. And of course, we'll spend some more time later on in the semester interpreting our data. This graphic helps you understand how the different steps come into play. When we begin, we identify our goals, and those goals always relate to some population of interest. We typically can't measure an entire population of interest, so we draw a sample from that population. Once we know the people who will be involved in our study, we will collect some data from them. And when we collect that data, we can summarize that data using sample statistics. We then want to use those sample statistics to estimate the population parameters. And once we know those population parameters, we can draw some conclusions about the population. In the case that we were looking at, we were trying to learn about the population of voters. All right. Throughout the semester, we're going to discuss the specifics of this entire process in much more detail. And we will next talk about sampling, not in this particular video. But I just wanted to give you a good understanding, essentially, of what these videos are like, and really just a general introduction right now into the process of statistics. Now, before I let you go, I just want to make sure you understand something, because you know I'm going to hold you to a high standard, because I really want you to learn about the things that we talk about. And believe it or not, you can learn a lot about statistics just by having a very good understanding of the basic definitions. And think about, in this short video, we already brought up several definitions. We talked about statistics, raw data, populations, population parameters, samples, representative samples, sample statistics. We talked about margin of error, confidence intervals, descriptive statistics, inferential statistics. If you can define each of those concepts and then provide some example that you can draw from your own head that's not just simply regurgitated from the textbook, then you're on the right track. Then you really know what's going on. So what I want you to do when you view one of these lectures before class is make sure you really understand this stuff, so that when you come to class, we can talk about this stuff in more detail, we can understand it at a deeper level, and really make use of our time. All right, my friends, that is the key content from section 1.1. I'll see you in class.